So we'll go from the Roman Empire and now to the oldest continuing civilization in the world, the Aboriginal people of Australia. So thank you for having me here today. It's an honour to be presenting at this conference. Imagines, what a theme, and do we have one for you? I'm the head of international and domestic engagement at the National Museum of Australia and proud board member of ICOM ICEE. As Alice in Wonderland said, what is the use of a story without pictures? So we've got lots. This presentation is more about seeing and hearing. It's about story, not tech. As Tim said this morning, never start with the tech. And I promise I didn't just rewrite my presentation. You join the dots. So Songlines, Tracking the Seven Sisters was a temporary exhibition at the National Museum of Australia. It won national awards in 2018 for the best exhibition in the temporary category, most outstanding exhibition overall, best web-based interactives in the digital category, which is why we're here today, merchandise award, and the film installation and virtual reality by Lynette Walworth also won her an Emmy. It's an exhibition the likes of which you and your audiences have never seen before. But why so many awards? How was this seminal or extraordinary? It's through the genesis of the project. So let's start with a story. At a meeting in 2010 in Canberra, the capital of Australia, head of the nation, an elder, David Miller, from the heart of the nation, leaned over a table and with a sense of urgency, in a hushed and weighty tones, said, "You mob got to help us. Our song lines are all broken up and we need your help to put them back together before it's too late." The community came to us. The museum didn't go to the community. The next generation don't want to hang around with the oldies anymore. They have different lifestyle choices. Their screens, they're plugged in, it's digital. So began a 7-year long journey of archival intent from which this exhibition was the public face. For the loss of these classical shards of history would be a loss to the heritage of not only Australia, but the world. Because just as the Iliad and Odyssey belong to the world, so do these. You just don't know it yet.
This is one of Australia's foundation stories, as ancient as the land itself.
An Australian story that immerses us in our country.
An epic tale of intrigue, desire, drama, and passion. A wild chase through the heart of the land.
These are the stories of my peoples to share with those who came after.
Our country, our people, our story.
Songlines, Tracking the Seven Sisters at the National Museum of Australia, Canberra.
So what are songlines? Hands up. Anyone know what a songline is? One, thank you. In a nutshell, songlines are a knowledge system for a non-text-based society. The Seven Sisters songline is an archetypal narrative of love, lust, tragedy, comedy, trickery, bravery, belonging to that of the great pantheon of epic sagas, which all civilizations have in order to explain the human condition. It's Australia's Book of Genesis. It is a story of essentially a man chasing a group of women with codes of social and moral behaviour weaved throughout. So let me tell you a little bit about Indigenous Australia. Indigenous knowledge is not stored in a man-made box sitting atop the land, which has no relevance to the stories held within. An old Inuit man once said, "The trouble with white fellas, they keep all their brains in books." Indigenous Australia is not a text-based culture, and there is not one single language. Australia is the size of Europe, so think about the multitude of languages across Europe and the multitude of cultural differences. Indigenous knowledge is archived in the land for eternity. Nyuru, the lustful pursuer of the Seven Sisters, whose face is graven into this 30-metre escarpment, is an ancestral shapeshifter who takes human form as he chases the women across the desert. But how did this foundation story translate into a museum context, or indeed an award-winning website? The museum must take on Aboriginal ways of knowing and being. So what does that look like? First, we must go to their office, and they must come to ours. where they reanimate the stories on canvas with performance, breathing life into dormant objects and paintings in storage. And their office again, mapping the songlines, seen more clearly here, using the Western knowledge system to plot sites with Google Earth. Ground-proof to future-proof. Over the 7 years, there were many a trip across 7,000 kilometres of the Australian desert. And on this trip, 10 cars, 30 elders, no roads, no Western map, only Indigenous knowledge. So how do we get from the desert to the gallery? It was an Indigenous-based governance model where the Jerkapa, the law, is central. It governs the knowledge system with Western ideas wrapped around it. We mapped the country across the gallery space with the three deserts. We modelled the gallery space, visualised the design for all involved so everyone could join in with the journey. But back to the genesis of the project. This was to get the next generation to participate in the process, to learn their story. And to really get the next generation in, you've got to make culture cool. As Curtis Taylor said, we're using the newest technology with the oldest culture. And it's not because the Indigenous knowledge system is faltering, it's actually evolving and responding. And this was black and white fella together. Beneficial to both, mutual understanding, a shared history. There has been a disconnect, and our roles in museums allow us to give vehicles to social change. And that's what Songlines did. It made an often inaccessible and foreign culture available to all Australians and to the world.
Kunkarangal pa come from north down to south. Tokorpapulka. Really, really big story.
And so that the world can see in Australia that this is a Tokorpapul for all the people.
Come and see.
So the protocol of giving permission to enter another's country is seen here at the entries to the exhibition, where a rotating group of virtual custodians beckons you in. Personal, like inviting one into your own home. The observance of this protocol and welcoming people to country in the context of a museum experience also enables visitors to feel included in a way not experienced in any other exhibition. As fascinated as one can feel, it can be a little voyeuristic in the context of colonialism, but not here. The elders' ownership and authenticity are established as they're telling other Australians that if you want to share this continent with us, you have to know your story. The history of the continent will forever remain a transplant and you'll never take root. As you may know, Australia is now home to people from over 200 nations. We are multicultural, but we don't all know the first Australian story. The inculcation of this new sense of shared ownership must be the best protections for cultural heritage. Shared ownership of a shared history. It's a paradigm shifter, with the elders' authority as owners of the exhibition established. No longer subjects of a colonial gaze or an advisory group or a reference group, but co-creators alongside museum curators and the institution. So here Matu welcomes you into the Matu section of the exhibition. And here the Central Desert welcomes you into the Central Desert section. And then there's the dome. Claimed to be the world's first, if not only high resolution traveling dome, it was placed in the centre of the gallery. We were digitising the dreaming. This was making culture cool, and it is preserving the story, animating the story, and sharing the story.
Really? been hearing.
Good tucker. The sisters are hungry. The snake disappears underground. The sisters start digging to capture the snake. Come here, come here. Have a look. Our cooker, our meat, went inside the hole. Come on, we dig out the cooker. Watimiru watches them digging. The sisters catch the snake, but there is something odd about it. They throw it up into the sky.
So as you can see, the dome immersive view is in the magic of the world's only known Seven Sisters rock art site, transporting visitors to the remote desert of Australia, but also animating the paintings. Paintings and knowledge within the paintings that are passed on performatively is now transmitted digitally through the animation within the dome. So visitors would lie under the dome and view these two videos that you've just seen. There's one more video here. As you entered the exhibition, you were also immersed in another digital experience, transported from the outside before you entered the exhibition, encountering the snake, the rain and the flowers that come. There was a VR that was alongside the exhibition as well, and large hunting ground painting, which was installed in the gallery with a multimedia installation animating it in time-lapse, but also decoding the painting to show the Aboriginal meaning and knowledge of the land on which it was painted. But let's look at the award-winning web-based interactive. Visitors can explore the remote rock art site at Cave Hill and the story of the Jampi figures, Seven Sisters Are Flying. Each intricate work was photographed in high resolution, 360 degrees, and you can spin and zoom and do all the fancy things that people like to do on websites. But it's the story that is attached. There's videos of the artworks being made, of the artists singing songlines. Visitors can take part in the process as you enter into the desert for an exclusive behind-the-scenes sense of the creation of these works. The interactive is well designed, it uses latest technology, but ultimately it could be transposed to other content. But used for any other exhibition, would it have won an award? The multitude of award for Songlines may be from the state-of-the-art technology, it may be from the stunning artworks, from the digital interactive, but truly this is not possible without story and without an authentic co-creation process. With ground-proofing for future-proofing the cultural heritage of the foundational Australian story that goes back some human occupancy of 60,000 years. The digital outputs become a new vehicle. It allowed experiences, immersion with visitors, learning through animated story, the Indigenous way, not a written text, but through art, story, performance, and song, and decoded the mystery. For all outputs, not surprisingly, it reeks authenticity. And I know Tim talked about it's quite a loaded word for us all. Its transformative power over people comes from the authentic voice. Powerful presence of the storytellers are visible and their voices are palpable. So why was it so successful? Let me reference Tim's keynote speech this morning that it was part of the experience economy. It was memorable and it was meaningful. There were invisible interfaces and a physical transformation to make human connection. So don't make the mistake of thinking it's only an Indigenous show or only an Australian exhibition. It is the intersections between the Western and the Indigenous worlds, or the spaces of the coloniser and the colonised, the ancient and the contemporary, not the usual hotly contested zone, but rather a highly collaborative one, sizzling in the intersections. And Songlines is a universal story, and your exhibition budget may be big if you're lucky, but like a Hollywood movie, it's only as good as the story. And Songlines is embarking on an international tour from 2021, so look out for it or come and speak to me if you'd like it at your museum. Thank you very much.